One day, after studying the deeper aspect of philosophy, psychology, doctrine, meditation, you come to know what it is. For the time being, to maintain, if not to gain some confidence, or to be mindful, this belief is very important. However, whether there are such people who watch or not, we know very well. In our subconscious mind, we record everything. It is not that purposely we record automatically. As soon as we implant the idea that we want to do this, before that mental energy converts into various other vibrations to use our physical body to do that, that concept that we developed in the mind already deposited in the subconscious mind. It is true. So that file is there. That is why in Western countries, when people hypnotize some others, they dig out this old record from their mind. A normal mind cannot remember all these things, because the mind, normal mind is engaged with the senses or mental object, mental image. When the mind is free from these six channels, that passive state can divert into the subconscious mind and can see what we have done, not only within this lifetime, during our previous birth also. But so far, only one particular case in Australia. But in other countries, they have developed only one previous birth. Could not go beyond that. The mental energy is not strong enough to go further. But there was one case in Australia, a lady who could remember seven previous births. And there was another American lady, Annie Besant, the theosophist, who respect Buddhism, Hinduism, Christianity, every religion, they are called theosophists. She lived in India. And she has developed only two previous births. Through hypnotism also, only that much. Then, the Edgar Cayce, American psychiatrist, a doctor, he developed his mind to get into trance without depending on any religion. In hypnotism also there is no God, no devas, no religion, only pure psychology. And this man also developed this without any religion, without any God. So he could manage to discover so many things to get cured his own sickness first. Later, he hypnotized others, and he has collected about 20,000 cases, still there in America, recorded 20,000 cases. Cured so many, but for others, you see, it is impossible to cure. Why? He said, during your previous birth, you have done this kind of bad deeds with cruelty or anger or jealousy. And this sickness or this kidney disease or this or that is the effect of your mental attitude. When rebirth takes place, that evil mental force also mix up. But this man never studied Buddhism, never believed about karma or rebirth earlier. But when he get into trance, he talk about rebirth and previous birth. So now you can understand. Actually, it is not necessary to depend on religion to understand this. To understand that it is true. Formally, we have to depend on religion. Because certainly you cannot understand, create more confusion in your mind. So simple, yet some are very meaningful. There are many things to learn.
Yamo mitta manussacha madhyatta verika picha sabbe satta sukhi hontu punyani pakatani me. Yama, deva of the underworld, deva of the underworld, not underground, underworld. So many devas in the town, you know, underground devas. Here we are talking about underworld. Humans, friends, indifferent ones, enemies too. May all beings be happy, sharing my merits. This is the Buddhist attitude. First, we have radiated or invited all the devas or some sort of supernatural living beings to share our happiness of the merits. Merits means good deeds that we have done with good intention. That's all. Yama is the name that religious people have given to the king of hell. Underworld means hell, because the belief that we maintain, the hell is underworld, below. As always when you talk about heaven and hell, you say heaven, our hand automatically goes. Then hell, this is our belief that we maintain thousands of years. And religions also support this idea, because religious people talk about heaven and hell, actually they also do not know where they are. Tell you frankly, just talk, they are not sure. I have told you earlier, the Buddha's attitude, not the Buddhist attitude. Actually, we are not practicing the Buddha's religion. We practice our own Buddhism. Buddhism or the Buddhist practices were introduced, promoted by us. So, we are going on organizing religious activities according to our needs, our satisfaction. All these practices we introduce as Buddhism. So just now I told you, in the Buddha's Buddhism, that means what the Buddha talk about, heaven and hell. He says, hell is not located somewhere under this earth. Hell is not situated under the great oceans or under the bottom of the Mahameru, the rock. Hells are everywhere. We are living beings, experience suffering. Whether they are human beings or animals or a spirit or ghost or any other form of living being. It depends on how they suffer. That is hell. Heaven, or to experience heavenly bliss, he says, it's not necessary for you to wait until you die. You can experience this heavenly bliss, or bliss, while you are living here on this earth. This is the Buddha's attitude. But we have developed, introduced, the heaven is above and hell is below. And later we also introduce there is a God who can send you to heaven and wash away your sins not to go to hell. Later they have introduced this belief, but that is not the Buddha's Buddhism. However, this is a belief that people maintained thousands of years. Whatever we talk, people never give up their belief. In hell also, there must be a ruler, isn't it? Animals, when you take group of animals in the jungle, they have one head and all the others follow. Birds also they have. I believe the ants also they have their own king. That means there must be somebody to guide the others. Whether they suffer or enjoy their life, it is immaterial. So the in charge of this hell, in the prison also, there is a chief, isn't it? But he does not suffer. So I do not know anything about king of hell, whether he too suffer or not. Anyway, I have seen a film. I was invited by the censor board, Film Nagara, to go and see this film, whether it is right or wrong. Then I found out something. Very good news for you. The king of the hell is a Chinese. Those days we used to visit that home where they keep naughty boys, mischievous boys, Sungai Besi, used to go and preach to them. And there I found out more Buddhists than others. Less Christians and Muslims and Hindus and more Buddhists. In the same manner. So, hell also, something like that. Even then, the ruler is a Chinese. That means a film. And there is another joke. This is not a Buddhist story. Don't take this as a Buddhist story. A visitor who wanted to go and survey the nature of hell, and he found out in the hell there are very big holes, pits, like wells here and there. And when those sinners, after committing all sorts of evils, go to hell, they take one by one and put into different wells. If Chinese go there, there's a separate one, drop into this one. He cannot come out. If Indians go there, are put into one particular well, cannot come out. Even then, they do not trust these people. Because they can climb on the top of the other and come out. Therefore, they have guard around the well. Day and night, watching. But there's one particular pit there, very deep one. There's no guard to watch. Then he asked, why? That particular place that you never employ any guard to watch, then they say in that place it's not necessary. Because the nature of that particular race is that one does not allow another person to come up. When one person climbed to escape, the other person pulled down. So no need to have any. So I don't want to mention what race is that. So the name of this hell, or the king, is Yama. It's a Pali word. We say Yamo Raja. Raja, king. King of the hell. His name is Yama. There was another religious cult long ago. When somebody is departed, after his or her death, all the others offer something to the king of hell and worship and pray. Pray to the king of hell, asking, please, if so and so happened to go there, please don't accommodate him, release him. That's right. But today, I think they have given up that prayer, but pray to God. When somebody dies, pray to God. Please send him to heaven. And don't send him to hell. This is a poor human mentality. Those who have not studied the nature of death and the nature of existence again, and how to relieve them, how to support them, they had their own imaginations, asking somebody else to assist. But in the Buddha's teaching, there is no such system. Worshipping or praying or offering to another person, whether Buddha or Bodhisattva or God or Devas or Brahmas, there is no such teaching. Because it is impossible to change. But directly we try to contact the departed person through our mental vibration by radiating. Although we cannot understand how our mental vibration works, psychologists can explain. They know how these things really work and how others can absorb and how we radiate our mental waves for good purpose as well as for bad purpose. When we radiate our hatred and enmity and jealousy and anger and ill will, also radiation, and the others experience the bad effects because of this poisonous mental vibration. On the other hand, when we radiate loving kindness, compassion and pity and sympathy with good intention toward them, they get some sort of relief through this mental vibration. To understand this clearly, we had to study the nature of mental activities, how mind works. Yesterday when I was reading a very interesting article, I read, according to anthropology, it has taken 600 million years, can you imagine, 600 million years for us to gain this brain, to maintain this human mind. Although the mind is not in the brain, I mean, brain can control and manipulate. Brain is responsible, but mind is not in the brain. So it is a gradual development. First started in the water, amoeba, then fish, then turtles, then developed evolution, reptiles, and four-legged, two-legged, then mammals change, now start to take milk from the mothers. Again, primitive stage, cave, when they were living in the cave, in the jungle, as primitive people, their development of their mind is not very advanced. Then today we stand here like human beings with human intelligence. And this human intelligence you cannot find in any other living beings because of the development of the brain. Let us take another example. You know, a valuable gem in certain countries, especially in Sri Lanka and some other countries, very valuable gem. People go and buy, spending few hundred thousand dollars for one stone. So when they dig the earth, they can see these gems. But if you study what you call gemmology, isn't it? Gemmology, isn't it? That. If you study, then you can understand how is ordinary stone convert, transform into valuable gem. How many millions of years it has taken for these changes, evolution. It's not that somebody created these gems underground. So everything here in this world, if you can study plant life, human life, animal life, stones and rocks, all these gradual development due to various factors, elements changing, various sources, forces, elements, known and unknown things. So we have discovered only one word for all these things. Not in there. God created. Finish. Nothing to study. At once, all these things created. At once. Within few minutes or few days. But very highly intellectuals all over the world are not ready to accept this. Because they can understand, according to scientific discoveries, how these things originated, how changes have taken place and evolutions and developments. So human brains to develop up to this stage taken 600 million years. That is why today the human mind can control the whole world, whole universe, going to control the whole universe one day. One human brain is enough for that. How powerful it is. So if we misuse this human mind today, so we have discovered so many things to destroy the whole world within half an hour. Human mind is working there. And who discovered atomic energy? By the human mind. By energy existence. No one could discover. There are many more things still we have not discovered. More powerful, more energetic than atomic energy. But if we can divert all these energies to the constructive purpose, you can do wonderful things. But unfortunately, man's selfishness completely ruins everything. Now they are using for destructive purpose, to destroy the mankind and the whole world. Selfishness, that is mine. Then who destroyed this world one day? Do you think God or devil? They have not discovered atomic energy. God has not discovered atomic energy. Man is the one who destroyed the whole world. So there is no meaning at all for us to worship this energy, asking not to destroy us. When you pray to somebody, ask him, please don't disturb, don't destroy, don't hurt. It's exactly like that. Go and pray to that energy, atomic energy, please don't destroy this world. It doesn't work. Man's mind is working there through this atomic energy. That energy alone cannot do anything. So you have to worship the man's mind, not to misuse it. So, the sufferings in hell, I think all of you know, is not permanent. No everlasting sufferings anywhere, in any part of the universe. For everything there is a period. There must be a limit. So we radiate, or we invite even the king of that hell who torture others to enjoy our happiness. We do not hate even the king of this hell. That is the idea. Pray. Manusa, human being. So we know and all the others, friends and relatives and all those human beings to share the happiness of our marriage. Because we have not done any harm to anybody. We did not disturb anybody to perform these meritorious deeds. We have done all these good work, good deeds with pure mind, with understanding, with compassion. Then it is called merits. If you perform any kind of religious service, by hurting or destroying another living beings in this world, you have reduced more than 50% of your meritorious deeds. Please remember this. Yamo Mitta. Humans, friends, indifferent ones. We have that mentality, indifference to others. That means we don't care. Just ignore. If not discriminate. No sympathy or kindness or understanding towards some people. Just shun them. But when we are going to invite, share our happiness, we invite all those known and unknown, anybody who is willing to share our happiness. I told you there are some people who maintain that by transferring merits to others, we may lose the real value of our merit. They cannot understand the nature of merit. Now, when you laugh due to your happiness in your mind, all the others laugh. Now, when you laugh due to your happiness in your mind, all the others laugh. That means they share your happiness. Do you lose your happiness? When you come to know that others laugh and you gain more happiness. And this is the nature of merits. When you transfer the merits to others, that is another meritorious deed. You increase the value of your meritorious deeds by doing so. Then, enemies is a very difficult thing for us to do. We hate enemies, but we do not know. By hating, we create a lot of bad karma. We do not know. You are not exempted just because you hate your enemies. When you hate yourself, do you know you create bad karma? When you suffer from various sicknesses, you hate. We cannot tolerate. It is hated. That means you pollute the purity of your own mind. Whether the object is yourself or another self. If you develop more enmity and jealousy and anger through this hatred, then you increase the degrees of your bad karma. Here, when you develop your hatred towards your enemy, many other evil forces also join with this anger. So if you can, invite them also, share this happiness. That means you have trained your mind. You have courage to do that. Your understanding is very deep. So one day we had to treat everybody equally without any discrimination. It is difficult at the moment, but we have to do that. May all living beings be happy. Sabbe satta sukhi hontu. This short sentence many people have memorized for their meditation. So they are going on reciting this. Sabbe satta sukhi hontu. Well, it is not compulsory for you to recite in the Pali language. You can use your own language. May all living beings be well and happy. Whether your prayers or your meditation really affect them or not, it is immaterial. The very moment when you start to think, may they be well and happy, at that moment, if you do that sincerely, at that time, you cannot maintain hatred, cruelty, anger in your mind. You have to remove this thing for the time being. If you really do that, otherwise just only mere utterance, just recite but the mind is boiling with anger or jealousy, that there is no effect at all. So if you want to do this, then you have to empty your mind from this evil hatred, cruelty and enmity. Then some sort of purity, at least for a few minutes, you can maintain. Otherwise, the mind is always covered with all these dirty things. That is why we are not happy. Very difficult for us to maintain cheerfulness, happiness, because of our mental attitude. Either selfishness, or craving, or greed, or jealousy, or anger, something is bothering. Then how to maintain? cheerfulness. Sabbe satta sukhi hantu punyani pagatani me, sharing my merit. Punya. Punya means merits. By sharing my merit, may they all be well and happy. So when you are alone, if you don't like to read any valuable religious books or something to learn, instead of going on creating imaginations and worrying, if you can, concentrate at least for a few minutes. May all living beings be well and happy. Radiate for a short while. At that time, you purify your own mind. You purify the atmosphere at home or the place where you live, where you work. And this mental vibration helps many other living beings to maintain some sort of peace, not only human beings. We have learned how devas share your happiness when you radiate, how other living beings like spirits or some others share your happiness, and how animals, they are very sensitive. And later, when you are very sincere, very kind, compassionate person, those animals also slowly come nearer to you. When they come to know you are trustworthy and you are kind. Now they don't like to come nearer to you, they're scared of you. They may go to another animal, but not a human being, scared. So, this is more than enough for us to understand the nature of our cruelty, selfishness, and cunningness. See, many of those birds, you can see, they go and sit down on the back of bulls, buffaloes, goats, elephants, horses, all the other living beings. Monkeys also go and jump and sit down on their back because they trust this animal. How many birds come and sit down on your head? How many wild animals come nearer to you? Yes, tigers, yes, pythons, only for that purpose. Because they don't trust you. This is the nature of human. The development of that human brain has taken place with selfishness, crookedness. The other animals or other living beings also have brain. The development also has taken place, but not yet these forces like selfishness and crookedness, cunningness, not yet developed. There may be a lesser degree. Those animals who associate with human beings, like cats and dogs who associate with human beings, learn these monkey tricks from human beings. Monkeys also learn monkey tricks from human beings. Next one. Sukhancha tividang dentu kippang papetha omatan imina punya kammena imina uddisena cha. May the triple happiness be attained now, after death, and finally, Nibbana. Three kinds of happiness that we experience through Buddhism. Now this is very important. Soon may all gain release from evil by these meritorious deeds and through this sharing. See, all these wordings are very meaningful, very simple, yet there are many things for us to learn. The triple happiness that we gain. Now this is very important. And this coming Sunday morning, they invited me to give a talk. The subject is, what do we gain from Buddhism? This is the beginning. Triple happiness. Happiness while we are living here. We can gain through Buddhism. Happiness that we experience after our death in the next life. Or as long as we exist in this samsara, in this wheel of existence. And the ultimate happiness that we experience in the end as the final goal. Triple happiness. Now, how to gain happiness while we are living here in this world? Now, we are trying to get blessings, happiness, and peace from others. That is why always they go to places of worship and ask blessing, blessing, blessing. That means they want to get peace from others. That gives a lot of confidence to many people. They feel some sort of consolation, satisfaction, psychological effect, experience. But we can create happiness by fulfilling our duties. Then we can satisfy. I have done my duties towards my parents, my husband, my wife, my children, my relatives, my religion, or not my religion, religion. Not nice to say my religion. That word is very bad word, my religion. Create a lot of problem. Religion. Why only my religion? Religion is religion. Religion, country, nation, not only my race. So one who fulfills his duties within his or her capacity, really satisfied with the life. Another way, by leading a respectable life, without hurting, disturbing, bluffing, cheating others. Very respectable, noble life. Those who can do that can experience more happiness than any other kind of worldly happiness. You may experience happiness by gaining more and more income, property, and good wife, good husband, good children, good house. Yes, all these things give happiness. But the same thing after some time turns the other way around. Create lot of troubles and worries and pains. You cannot stop that. So that happiness is uncertain. The thing that you regarded as happiness through this thing, after some time become real suffering, burdens, torture to you But the happiness that you experience by leading a respectable life, harmless life, never create any disturbances, disappointments in your life. Throughout your life, you experience that happiness. Any moment when you think about your way of life, you develop that happiness. You gain confidence. I see the difference now. So don't wait to gain this happiness or peace in your life simply by worshipping or praying or asking blessing from others. You can create your own effort, your discipline, your understanding are the important thing. In spite of various problems and troubles at home or in the country, in the world, still you can maintain some sort of satisfaction in your life if you can understand the nature of worldly condition. Now we have come to another aspect. Assume you have a lot of problem at home or in the place where you work. If not outside, you cannot stop them. But you cannot gain happiness or satisfy or stop all these things simply by worrying about them. Your worries aggravate the situation. Then understanding people have some sort of methods. Without accusing, blaming, creating further problems and troubles, they try to understand the nature of life, facts of life. So we are creating daydreams about our life, not knowing what this life is. And we want to convert this world into a paradise, to live without facing any problems and troubles and difficulty, to enjoy our life forever. This is the way how we create dreams. When we experience that the difficulties of gaining what we wanted, we create worries, miseries, disappointments, unhappiness in our mind. So if we can learn how to face facts, the formations of physical body and the life is like this. Not according to my own satisfaction. I claim this is my body. Right? If this is my property, why should I suffer? I don't like to suffer. Why should I gain sicknesses that I don't like? Why should I have to suffer as an old man, old lady? So it clearly shows this is not mine. That means I cannot adjust or arrange anything according to my wish. Then how can I claim that this is mine? If you can understand this much, we can reduce a lot of sufferings and worries and disappointment. Again, we maintain some sort of individualism, claim my life, my body, my spirit, my soul. What is that you claim as mine? It is like this. Let us take electricity, electric energy, and we produce some sort of gadgets, and this is one of them. or lamp, bulb. So we arrange everything, fix everything, switch on. We get the light. Then I say, this is my lamp, my light. I claim, this is my light. This is not your light. That is electric energy. The gadgets that you fix here, created by you, and that one also breakable, changeable. So the light is not your light, it is electric energy. When you claim that this is my light, my lamp, then the troubles start from there. The whole world fight today because of this, mine. Things that exist in this universe, we separate one unit. The existing thing we separate, just like electricity. After that we claim this is mine, our. My life, my family, my wife, my husband, my children, my house, my country, my religion, my race. The trouble, all our troubles are based on this. But to understand this, my dear friends, you know how long you had to learn, think, analyze, realize? Not so easy. But to maintain satisfaction and peace in our life, this is the correct method. Not necessary to go and beg peace and happiness from another person. We know what it is. We know what this world is. Although we claim this is our world, what guarantee is there that suddenly some sort of volcanic eruption, earthquake, fire, flood can destroy the whole world? So we claim this is our world. All these things are impermanent, uncertain. Our way of life also uncertain. So we must know how to face certain things. And we can overcome so many other things by knowing the real situation, by knowing the nature of worldly condition. What are the conditions? Changes, ups and downs, ups and down. Now this is the nature of life. Always ups and down. This is called 8 kind of worldly condition. So we are subject to this universal law of worldly condition, not created by devils or God or anybody. The world exists because of this worldly condition. Changes take place because of this world condition. There is nobody behind to manipulate, to switch on the button. Another method. Now how many methods I have shown for you to maintain happiness while we are living here? Katha punyo ubhayatta nandati, the Buddha says. Those who have done meritorious deeds, experience happiness here while they are living in this world and hereafter, both. Every time when you think, oh, I have done this kind of meritorious deed, merit many good deeds, I have supported others, I could many to relieve others' sufferings. I have supported poor people. I have supported some others for their studies. I have led so many people to lead a religious, respectable life. I could manage to stop so many evil, wicked, cruel deeds. All these are meritorious deeds. So when you think in that way, the happiness that you experience is remarkable while you are living. And after your death also, you can continue this happiness. But the happiness that you maintain by thinking about your property and family and all those things, yes, you can maintain up to the last moment. Sometimes you can die with satisfaction, thinking you have done your duties, worldly obligation. But if you have not done anything for the next life, so you have not fulfilled all your duties. That's why the Buddha said, Ubhaya, both, here and hereafter also, gain happiness. Again, when we are going to die, I think majority of us create more unhappiness, disappointment, frustration. When you think of property, family, wife, husband, children, and the position, how to die? This will become a very big problem. Cannot die. So that person cannot die peacefully. So if we want to die peacefully, fulfill all our duties, don't develop that strong attachment towards material thing at the last moment. The mind must be free. Then you can bring back all the good deeds, meritorious deeds that you have done. Oh, I have done this and this and this. These things gives confidence and happiness, not your property. Then you can die peacefully with confidence, because you can understand. If another existence or rebirth take place, that life cannot become a miserable one. Because you have accumulated enough merits. That means you never go from this world as a bankrupt person.